Hello everyone. I, Sadia Firdaus, a student of BPT second year from Jamia Millia Islamia, will discuss on the topic impaired balance and balance training. I hope I'll be able to cover all the sections under the concerned topic. So let's start. Firstly, to study impaired balance, we should briefly know what is balance. So balance describes the dynamic process by which the body's position is maintained in equilibrium. That is, the body's center of mass has to be maintained within the base of support for balance to be greatest. Or in literal words, I can define it as to be the upright and steady position so that one does not fall. Next is limits of stability. This is basically the sway boundaries in which an individual can maintain equilibrium without changing his or her base of support, while these boundaries can change according to the task. Any deviations in the body's center of mass position relative to the boundary, they are corrected intermittently, producing a random swaying motion. Next is impaired balance, which can be caused by injury or disease to any of these structures involved in the three stages of information processing, that is sensory input, sensory motor integration, and motor output generation. Then obviously the deficits with aging, they will also lead to frequent falls. Then we come to sensory input impairments. The proprioceptive impairments have been found to contribute to balance deficits. Obviously, if there is some decreased joint position sense, so that has been reported in individuals with recurrent ankle sprains. Then somatosensory, visual, and vestibular deficits, they may impair the balance and mobility. Any visual loss that is caused by any disease or trauma, it will impair balance and lead to falls. Then individuals with damage to vestibular system because of viral infections or the TBI, that is the traumatic brain injury, or aging, may experience vertigo and postural instability. Then sensory motor integration impairments, damage to the basal ganglia, cerebellum, it will impair the processing of the incoming sensory information and lead to postural instability. Then in this section, a small topic that is sensory organization for balance control, this becomes important. Like basically when the sensory inputs from any of the system is inaccurate, owing to the environmental conditions or injuries, so that will decrease the information processing rate. So the CNS, what does the CNS do? It basically suppresses the inaccurate input and select and combine the appropriate sensory inputs from the other two systems. And this adaptive process is called as sensory organization. Most individuals can compensate well if one of the three systems is impaired, and therefore this concept is basis for many treatment programs. And why I discussed the sensory organization here, because many people face sensory organization problems. So basically the sensory organization problems that manifest as over-reliance on one particular sense for balance control, or a more generalized inability to select an appropriate sense for balance control when one or more senses give inaccurate information. So it is demonstrated in many patients. So basically the individuals who rely, like in some individuals who are relying heavily on visual inputs, right? That is, they are visually dependent. So they will become unstable, or they will fall under some conditions. Then we come to the biomechanical and motor output generation. Obviously, the if there is any deficit in motor components of balance control, like the joint, there is a joint range of motion limitation, or there is poor posture, or there is impaired motor coordination, so all these will lead to balance impairments. And if impaired range of motion or muscle strength is present at one joint, so it will also alter the posture and balance movements throughout the entire limb. Or like in individuals with neurological conditions like stroke or the TBI or Parkinson's disease. So there is an abnormal tone or impaired coordination of motor strategies. So there will be failure to generate the adequate muscle forces, which will limit the person's ability to recruit the muscle required for balance. Then pain. pain can also alter your movement, right? So if and if this pain is persistent, then it will obviously produce secondary strength and mobility impairments. Then elderly individuals, they are also more susceptible to falls, which lead to loss of confidence and thus balance deficits. So next we come to the management part of impaired balance. It is a very important step. So a comprehensive evaluation becomes important for individuals with balance problems. In this, we'll be asking the patient about his history of falls, like onset of fall, the frequency of fall, or the activity which the patient was doing at the time of fall. Then there was presence of vertigo, dizziness, was there or not. Then we'll be doing an assessment to identify the sensory input, that is the proprioception, visual, vestibular, then the muscle strength, range of motion. We'll be assessing all these aspects. Thus, clinicians should carefully select a variety of tests and measures to assess all the various types of balance control, and the selection of a good intervention program and tests and measures becomes important. Then this is a table which shows the balance assessments and interventions. First category is static balance control, and it is describing the different tests and interventions which can be used. Now, what is static balance control? It is basically maintaining a stable anti-gravity position while the patient is at rest, like he's in standing position or in sitting position. Right, so that is the static balance control. Now, the test which static balance control involve is the Romberg test. Now, what is Romberg test? It is basically the patient's ability to stand with the feet parallel and together with the eyes open and then closed for 30 seconds. Right. So when the patient will close his or his eyes for 30 seconds, if there is a tendency to fall, then that will be the positive Romberg test. Then second test is sharpened or the tandem Romberg. It basically requires the patient to stand with the feet in heel to toe position, that is basically the tandem stance, with arms folded across the chest and eyes closed for 1 minute. And both these tests, that is the Romberg test and the sharpened Romberg test, these both tests are important for establishing the person's balance status. Then comes the single leg stance test. The single leg balance stance test, basically in this, the patient is allowed to stand on one leg without shoes, with arms crossed or hands on hips without letting the legs touch each other. Then comes the stroke stand test. It is basically performed by having the patient stand on both feet with hands on the hips, then lift one leg and place the toes of that foot against the knee of the other leg. On command from the tester, the patient then raises the heel to stand on the toes and tries to balance for as long as possible without letting either the heel touch the ground or the other foot move away from the knee. Normal adults should be able to balance for 20 to 30 seconds on each leg. Then comes the dynamic balance control test. Now in this, basically you are stabilizing the body when the support surface is moving or when the body is moving on a stable surface, such as sit to stand, transverse, walking, etc. The test is like 5 times sit to stand test, 5 into STS. In this, basically the person is seated on a chair with the arms across the chest, and then he stands up and then he sits back down as quickly as possible, 5 times consecutively while he is being timed. And if a score of greater than 15 seconds on the 5 into STS is found, then it will predict recurrent falls. Then is anticipatory balance control test. In this, the patient performs voluntary movements that require the development of a postural set to counteract the predicted postural disturbances, like patient's ability to catch balls, open the doors, lift objects without losing balance. So this involves the anticipatory or the feed forward. The test which is involved in this is the FRT, that is the functional reach test or the multidirectional reach test. In this test, the patient reaches in different directions as far as possible without changing his base of support. Then the star excursion balance test or the SEBT, it is a test of the lower extremity that challenges an individual's limit of stability. In this, the patient is basically instructed to reach as far as possible with one leg in each of the 8 prescribed directions while maintaining balance on the contralateral leg. And this test is very much reliable and has a validity to detect the dynamic balance deficits in individuals with chronic ankle instability, ACL deficiency, etc. Then a modification of the SEBT test is the YBT test. In this, basically, we are allowing the patient to reach with one leg in only in 3 directions: anterior, posteromedial, and posterolateral. Then comes the reactive balance control test. This is automatic postural responses can be assessed by patient's response to external perturbations. This involves the push test or the pull test. Interventions involve standing away, ankle strategy, hip strategy, stepping strategy, etc. Like if we talk of the push test, then in this it can be a, you know, small or large, slow or rapid, which will be applied in different directions on the patient. Then the pull test, push and release test, postural stress test. These tests are more objective and reliable measure of reactive postural control. Then is sensory organization. This involves like the CTSIB, clinical test of sensory integration and on balance test, and the balance error scoring system. Like in this, if we talk about the balance error scoring system, then this is again a clinical test of postural stability that requires an individual to assume 3 different stance position like the double leg, single leg and tandem while he's standing on a firm surface and then standing on a piece of foam with eyes closed for a total of 6 20-second trials. Now what the tester needs to observe? The tester needs to observe for 6 types of errors in performance, like if the patient has opened his eyes or he's taking some steps while his eyes is closed, stumbles or falls. So performance is scored by adding 1 error point for each error committed. So the balance error scoring system, it has moderate to good inter-error reliability and it is useful for identifying the balance deficits in individuals. Right? Then next involves the functional test or the balance during functional activities. Now these functional tests are used to determine the activity limitation and participation restrictions and to identify tasks that a patient needs to practice. Now what is activity limitation and participation restriction? So basically activity limitation is when a person is unable or has only limited ability to perform any of the whole body component motions like reaching and grasping, lifting, lowering, carrying, bending, twisting, turning, throwing, hopping, jumping, kicking an object, then ascending and descending stairs. And participation may be restricted, that is involvement in different situations. For example, if I say like a person wants to paint the wall of his house, right? So his inability to grasp the brush or climb the ladder, that will be the activity limitation. And his inability to perform the task of painting, it may result in participation restriction. So this clearly defines the activity limitation and participation restriction. Now different tests is like the Berg balance scale, timed up and go test, etc. And last is safety during gait locomotion or balance, which is obviously essential during examination. Interventions which we can involve is balance within stability limits or the environmental, we can do some environmental modifications while dealing with safety during balance. Then you can have a glance at these pictures. Like this first test is the, this is the Romberg, then this is the sharpened Romberg, this is the functional reach, this is the Stokes stand test, this is sit-to stand test, and this is the single leg stance test. Then this is the table, and it includes the CTSIB. This table is basically giving a description and scoring of the different tests which we talked last. Okay, so now we come to balance training, which is another important topic. So balance training, it involves balance improvements, which will depend on the patient's status of impaired balance. So whatever intervention the programmer is choosing, it should be chosen very wisely. Next, focus of attention. That is also an important aspect when we improve the balance performance. So like what is external focus of attention? Like if I say, if a person is balancing on a tilt board and he is holding a bar in his outstretched hand, then if he is given the instruction to keep the bar horizontal, or if the person is standing on a tilt board, so instruction would be to keep the board horizontal. So this this type of instruction will be the external focus of attention. While for internal focus of attention, the performer, if standing on a tilt board, then will be instructed to keep the feet horizontal or keep the trunk posture straight. Then this method of letting the performer to focus on body movements of position will be the internal focus of attention. But generally, the performers, generally, they are allowed to focus more on the external focus of attention, because it facilitates the use of unconscious past reflexive control processes and speeds up the learning process. Okay, so now I'll be discussing separately about how to deal the balance improvements in static balance control or the dynamic or anticipatory, like that. So for the static balance control, you can allow the patient to maintain the sitting, half kneeling, tall kneeling and standing postures on a firm surface. Then you can promote the external focus of attention by allowing the patient to hold a bar in his outstretched hand and telling him to maintain the bar in the horizontal position, which will focus more on his external focus of attention. We can further progress the activities by, you know, changing the basic positions of sitting, half kneeling, by telling the patient to do the activity in tandem stance or single leg stance in squat position. So this will be more challenging for the patient. Then we can even narrow the base of support. We can tell the patient to close his eyes, and we can even provide resistance via the elastic resistance or handheld weights, which will also be challenging. Then next, we can add some secondary tasks like catching a ball or mental calculations to increase the level of difficulty. Next is dynamic balance control. Now for this, the patient can practice the balance control on moving surfaces, like sitting on the therapeutic ball, standing on wobble boards, or bouncing on a mini trampoline. Then progression can be, like, the patients can be allowed to, you know, shift the body weight, move the arms, rotate his trunk. Then he can also, you know, include hopping, skipping, rope, jumping, etc. Next is anticipatory balance control. Now, anticipatory balance control basically involves interventions of, you know, touching or grasping objects, catching a ball or kicking a ball. So we will be focusing on such thing. For variations, different postures can be used, like sitting, standing and kneeling. Then we can even involve such type of functional tasks that involve multiple parts of the body to increase the challenge to anticipatory postural control. Then we talk of reactive balance control. Now, reactive balance control ke liye, we can have the patient work to gradually increase the amount of sway in different directions while standing on a firm stable surface. And to emphasize the training of the ankle strategy, have the patient practice while standing on one leg with trunk erect. Now, what is ankle strategy? Ankle strategy is basically in the quad stance and small perturbations. There will be some movements at the ankle joint so as to restore the person's center of mass to a stable position and maintain his balance. So for small perturbations that are causing a loss of balance of body in the forward direction. So muscle activation usually proceeds in a distal to proximal position, that is from gastrocnemius activity followed by hamstring and finally by the paraspinal muscle activation. And in response to backward instability, it will begin in the anterior tibialis, then quadriceps, and then obviously the abdominal muscles. Next, to emphasize the training of the hip strategy, have the patient walk on balance beams or lines drawn on the floor, perform the tandem stance and single leg stance with trunk bending. Now, what is hip strategy? Hip strategy for rapid or large external perturbations offer movements executed with the center of gravity near the limits of stability. A hip strategy is employed. Basically, this strategy uses hip flexion or extension to move the center of mass within the base of support. Then in response to forward body sway, that is the support surface moving backward. Obviously, if the support surface is moving backward and there is a forward body sway, then the muscles are typically activated in the proximal to distal sequence, that is from abdominals followed by activation of quadriceps. And backward body sway, that is the support surfaces will move anteriorly, forwardly. So it will result in activation of first of the paraspinals followed by the hamstrings. Then to emphasize the stepping strategy, have the patient practice stepping up onto the stool or stepping the legs crossed in front. Now, what is stepping strategy? If a large force is displacing the center of mass beyond the limits of stability, then the person will take a forward or backward step to enlarge the base of support and regain the balance control. So this uncoordinated step that follows a stumble on the uneven ground is the best example of stepping strategy. This image is clearly defined. This is the ankle strategy. Movements at the ankle joint is restoring the center of mass during small perturbations. Hip strategy, the person is using hip flexion so as to maintain his balance for rapid and large perturbations. Then there is a step, an uncoordinated step has been taken by the person so as to maintain his center of mass. So this is the stepping strategy. Next is balance during functional activities. This will obviously include telling the patient to do such tasks of daily living, because maybe the patient is not able to do that particular task, or his doing of task is limited. So like if we are focusing on his ability to reach something, so we'll be like, we can tell the patient to work on activities such as reaching for a glass in the cupboard, catching a ball off center. And for complexity, we can perform two or more tasks simultaneously. We can even practice recreational activities the patient enjoys, like golf. So as the patient is, mostly interested and involved, and we can even increase the patient's motivation, and while we are simultaneously challenging the balance control also. So this will be the best intervention for balance activities. Next is safety during balance. Obviously, whenever you are doing balance activities or you are doing balance training, then safety is also must. So emphasize safety. Have the patient practice postural sway activities within their actual stability limits and progress dynamic activities with emphasis on promoting function and external focus of attention. Obviously, if the patient is not doing the activity in his actual stability limits and, reaching or doing the activity beyond his limits of stability, then obviously there will be fall, which will lead to other problems. Further, environmental modifications can also be made according to the patient's need. Like if the patient is not able to do the activities in a very hot environment, so we'll change the environment according to patient so that he's able to do the concerned activity and a balanced training is fulfilled. So the PPT has been made by taking references from the therapeutic exercise, foundations and techniques, Kistner and Colby, and from physical rehabilitation, 7th edition, Sullivan. So I hope I'm able to make you understand the concepts and topic clearly. So that's all for the topic. Thank you.